is the first distinguished lecture of the school year, and you are in for a treat. And before we get started, I'm going to just acknowledge a few people here. First of all, my fellow deans who have come to join us, would you please stand and be recognized? I saw a few here. Colleagues, please stand and be recognized. And we have members of the Kimmett team here who I know that Mr. Luke will let you meet them when he gives his remarks. But I would also like to welcome two members of the Hall of Fame who are also on the Board of Trustees, Mr. Alan LeBan. Take this opportunity now to welcome the reason that we're here, all of the students here tonight. Would you please give us, as President Hamburg would ask you to do, an exciting, loud fins up. I would also like to thank and recognize all of those who have helped to put this together. This is indeed a wonderful experience for all of us, especially for the students. And so without further ado, I would like to bring to the podium to introduce our guest speaker, our president, Dr. George Hamburg.
That he didn't introduce was former president, now chancellor, my predecessor, Mr. Ray Ferrero, Jr. Now, I want y'all, as students, to think about these numbers. 1.2 billion, 16,000, 27, and 98. What does that have to do with introducing the speaker? Per Luf, who's been accompanied for moral support this evening by his lovely wife, Elsa. Thank you. $1.2 billion as a global public company on the New York Stock Exchange that went from rags to riches under your speaker's leadership. And if you want to buy stock, buy it now. 16,000 is the number of employees that are in Kimmett. 27 manufacturing plants in 98 countries. Wow. 1.2 billion, 16,000, 27 manufacturing companies in 98, and Pear has been to all of them. We were talking before that he subscribes to the same theory I do, and that is managing by wandering around. Albert calls it MBWA, right, Albert? Where are you? The Professor of the Year. Ladies and gentlemen, it's indeed my privilege and pleasure to introduce an individual who's really Noble Southeastern University long before he was honored as a Hall of Fame. He was on the board of governors of the business school before it was a college. He also has been intricately involved with the Alan and Susie Levin Ambassadors Board since its inception, practically. He comes to the meetings, he participates, and unfortunately, I've had to cancel lunch with him twice, but he won't let me forget it. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce you to an individual who one thing we do share in common. As president of Cincinnati, and George Hanbury is president of Nova Southeastern University, we've had the honor and the privilege of sharing a chairman. Chairman of the board, Mr. Ron Asaf. Ron, please. Say something to these students that I know will be expected to hear from you. Thank you.
Sometimes to believe what people say about you. But it's better not, actually. So, as the sun rises in Africa, the gazelle wakes up and he realizes that unless he can outrun the fastest lion, he will not live to see another sunrise. The lion, at the same time, wakes up and he realizes that unless he can outrun the slowest gazelle, he will starve. In Africa, it doesn't matter whether you are a gazelle or a lion, when the sun rises, you better be running. What this story sort of tells you is that for all of us, we need to move. And there really isn't a safe haven anywhere. There's been a conversation about speed and direction. There was a famous leader of Intel way back in the 90s who said, he used the Clint Eastwood movie, The Quick and the Dead, and said there was only two types of businesses in the world, which is the quick and the dead. I'd like to add my experience to that and see how you can balance, on the one hand, speed, which of course is important at all times, but also direction and quality of work. And how different cultures view this. And I've had the incredible experience of being allowed to play in different playgrounds around the world. And when you compare where we come from, the Judeo-Christian tradition, to the tradition you see in the East, basically from Confucius, you find that we may look at things a little differently. In Japan, they love the sunrise. Where I grew up, we love the sunset. So if you go to Mount Fuji, and you will go up, you are actually, they will figure out a way so you reach the top of Mount Fuji when the sun is rising. If this was in Sweden, where I was born, you would get up there when the sun is setting. So just a different thing to think about. So let me talk a little bit about Kemet, and I'll get into the subject in a bit. What are we? Well, we make components, various types. And mostly we make capacitors, and I know this is a business school, but I'm sure you have some engineering capability in this room, I'm sure. But what a capacitor does, it'll store, it'll filter, it'll regulate electrical energy. In anything that plugs in, that turns on and off, that uses a battery. Simply put, if there is voltage, you need one of these things. They come in various forms. Some you dig up, they start like this. And some materials, they're actually called tantalum. Some is made from ceramics,
and plastics. Some are for, you know, lower voltage applications like such like as these. There are about, I'd say, 800 capacitors in them, this little thing. They're not so big, but, some are used in high voltage type capabilities. We make a whole bunch of different ones. We make, well, this is actually a big capacitor, a lot of voltage, probably used in a windmill. This is a DC link capacitor, which is used in, this one is in a car, actually. So it will actually help, you know, change the DC voltage to AC voltage. And this is a capacitor that's basically used in computers mostly. It's made from tantalum, has an organic feature to it. And these are, you know, some smaller ones that are used in all kinds of applications. We make about 1,400 of these types every second. So let's talk a little bit about the company. We, as George was saying, you know, we are pretty global. We make 48 billion of these every year in our manufacturing facilities. And of course, we are trying to be easy to buy from, meaning that we want our customers to feel that this is the company that cares about them, that listens to what they have to say, and actually makes the whole transaction simple. And we also want to be easy to design in, because all of these things that we make, whether it's this or whether it's this, an engineer has to sit down and figure out how is it going to fit in the particular application where they are. So they have to be easy to design in. And this is where we have our manufacturing plants all over the world in various locations, of course, as you can imagine, 6 in the US or the Americas, 7 in Europe, and the rest in Asia. We've had an interesting year. For some reason, nobody really believed our story way back. Not so way back, actually, maybe a year and a half ago. They thought we were full of whatever. I'm not going to use the word. But somehow they started believing that maybe there is a story behind what we were doing. So the stock went completely crazy. Well, they went up, let's put that way. Some may have a different perspective on this. So, you know, I was about to announce the results of this last quarter that ended September 30th. And this was the best quarter the company had ever done. Revenue was up 55% from a year before. Profit was 4x. EPS was way above what we had. We had, you know, almost 100 million, 200 million more in cash than we had the year before. So not a bad performance, I thought. So I was feeling like this. And it was actually funny. I was asked, they asked, what are you going to do with the money? Like, you know, it's not my money, but, you know, I'm sort of the stewardship of them. What do you do with the money? I said, I'm just going to look. So I was feeling pretty good. And just when you think you have it all figured out, boom. For some reason, which is completely unexplained today, we lost a lot of value when we announced the earnings as good as they were. So welcome to the life of a public company CEO. You have no idea where it's going to come from. There is a boulder someplace, there is a curveball someplace, and something happened. So I was basically feeling more like this. So let me just share a few things about me that I think had framed my reference and my frame of mind. Of course, I was born in Sweden, so which was part of Europe. And of course, when I grew up, Sweden was very relative to the rest of Europe, partly because it hadn't been in the war. So all the plants were all ready to roll out and, you know, send Volvos and Saabs and whatever else around the world. But the thing that I want to talk about is that my dad, for some reason, believed that it was important to experience other cultures. So every summer, from when I was like 7 till I was like 16, I think, the family was packed in a car. It wasn't really a choice. I mean, it was just show up and sit down and we're going to go on a trip. And for 4 weeks, every summer, we toured Europe. 5,000 miles every summer. He used the local AAA, wasn't called AAA, of course, but the local AAA, and got a guide for what we should go and so forth. And of course, in those days, people did not speak, neither did I, but they didn't speak. So you had to figure out a way to communicate with folks from these different cultures in whatever language they had. Today, you go to France, to Paris, and they will all speak English. You go to Germany, they will all speak English. In those days, none of them did. So that framed my thinking a lot about, and my curiosity, and maybe my wanderlust, the fact that I've been traveling, so I travel a lot, but I get a lot of energy from that as well. But maybe that's what framed it. Another thing that framed it is, I cleaned up for this photo, by the way. It's my senior high school book, picture in from California. So I got a scholarship to study for a year as a foreign exchange student in the US. I had never been, and most people that I knew had never been. So I went to California, and basically that experience is something that has framed a lot of what I do and a lot of how I think about things. So, talking a little bit about what happened to me, and I was doing my PhD, and then somebody called up and said, would you like to work for Anderson Consulting and go to California or go to the US and do that? And I said, well, I hadn't thought about that, but yeah, maybe that could be interesting. So so I went to California. And it was then called Anderson Consulting, now it's called Accenture. And after a few years, I was asked for some reason to go back to Sweden and start the consulting practice. I was 27 years old. And I'm sure they didn't check with the partnership that whoever made this decision, because I was way too young and way too experienced. I did speak the local lingo, though. That was one thing that I had up on the rest of them. So I came back and started up the practice. I was mentored by a Norwegian partner, Finnberg Jakobsen, who was probably one of the smartest men I've ever met. And he was supportive. He let me go and do things I probably didn't think I could do, and let me run undercover for quite some time, and we grew quite a nice little business. Talking about mentors, I've had three mentors in this period that have meant a lot to me. And they gave me tasks I didn't think I was ready for. And I think it's a thing for all of you students here, get yourself a mentor or two that believe more in you than you believe in yourself, and can push you to limits you probably never thought you could do. Anyway, I left Anderson with a heavy heart, actually, I have to say, because I enjoyed it very much there, and I came to a company called Digital. It is not part of Hewlett Packard, but DEC, as it was fondly called at the time, and those of you who have gray hair may remember Digital Equipment, right? May even have worked on some of their equipment if you were engineering-oriented. And at the time, it was absolutely the Facebook of the age, for sure. It was the coolest company, in my humble opinion, the coolest company to work for. And think about these things. It was a company that invented the 64-bit chip. I'm sure you're all, engineering savvy enough to know what that means. It invented peer-to-peer computing. It had email file sharing way before anybody had any idea how to do that. It was the DEC.com was the first one connected to the internet. I had email at home in those days. Didn't work fast. Could send no pictures, but I could send messages. So when I meet students, I kind of think of it that I was probably a nerd before you were out of grade school. they gave me great opportunities. I was asked to form a joint venture with Ericsson on banking systems when I was 34 years old. When I was 38, I was managing the acquisition of a $1 billion computing company that we put into the organization. So here's another guy, Piacolo Falotto, an Italian, who thought I can do things I didn't think I could do myself. Again, make sure you find a good mentor. I went to NCR, and I was in charge of the banking side of NCR. I would make cash machines, if you remember, ATMs. And when I came to that company, the ATM sales were flagging. It was not doing well. It looked poor. Technology was not all that good. We didn't have time to fix the technology, but we can fix the way it looks. So we put a new fascia in place. We put some colored applications on a Microsoft system that you could see in the window. And also, we offered the ATMs any color you could like. So you could buy them red or green or red and green or checkered. So my manufacturing guy was actually a Scottish guy. He went berserk. He said, "You crazy? Do you know what it takes to put color to paint one of these things?" And I said, "Rob." Not to worry. The customer, they're going to look at all these things and all these colors, they're going to smile, which is exactly what happened. But a couple of things I learned during these starting days. First was you gotta work hard. You need to put in a few 24-hour shifts. You need to know what it feels like to just work around the clock. And I'm sure as students you're doing that. I realize that sometimes every day is a Wednesday. You work the last two, I'm going to work the next two, every day is a Wednesday. And you need to be chargeable. You need to be able to, whenever you work, make sure that whatever you produce is somebody wants that to like the output of your work. Then, out of the blue, somebody called me and said, would you like to go to Southeastern U.S.? And Ron Asaph believed that I could be of some support and with his company that he founded in 1968 and had run into some issues. He believed I can do it. Some unknown Swede living in London at the time was asked to come to Boca Raton and to run Sensormatic, his baby, if I may. They call it your baby. He's the reason I'm here. Otherwise, I probably would be somewhere else. So thank you, Ron. But I reached out to one of my other mentors, a guy called Randall Thomas, who I worked for at Anderson a long time ago, even. And I asked him, would you give a reference to him? And he, allegedly, I've been told the story. He told a headhunter, probably, that, what was the name of that company he's going to work for? Sensormatic. Is it public? Okay, you hire him, I'm going to buy stock. I hope he did. But it was like, it felt like I was going to beat the Steelers in Pittsburgh or beat Man United in Old Trafford or whatever, you want to compare it to. But it also, we needed to put the team together. There was a great franchise in the business, a lot of opportunity. But the team had to work together and embrace opportunities. And remind you of the story of, maybe I need to see absolutely still. That's going to be hard. But anyway.
Go ahead.
Are you doing something? Okay. All right. It reminds me of a story from the war, during the Battle of the Bulge, right at the end of the war when the Germans were attacking the Americans and the Brits and in Belgium and France. And during this particular time, a general called Antonin McAuliffe, he had his troops surrounded in this little village in Belgium. And the German general offered him to surrender. And the general sent a note back to the German general, said, nuts. And then he assembled his troops and he said, men, we're surrounded by the enemy. That means we have the strongest opportunity presented to any army ever. We can attack in any direction we like. So that's how I felt with Sensormatic. There was opportunity everywhere. We can go in any direction and make good sense. We were engineering products. I actually decided, I was, the engineering guys are always a little suspicious of, economists, liars from a training perspective, and, CEO, he probably doesn't understand any of it. So I decided to get myself a patent just to prove that I can do it. I don't think we made much money from my patent, but at least I got a patent. So revenue was up, profit was up, we were feeling really good. And just when I thought everything was going fine, we got a call from a company that wanted to buy us. And I was told by my now friend, then boss, no brinksmanship there. Because they wanted, the price they wanted to pay for the company was in a league that was certainly interesting from the shareholders. So even if you're the CEO of a company, it's not, particularly in the public domain, it's not yours. It's not your money. You work for the shareholders. So I think we made the shareholders reasonably happy, Ron, right? Yeah,
very happy.
So the shareholders were happy, and I was unemployed. So I was down to feeding the ducks and playing golf, neither one of which I'm very good at. So suddenly, Kemet asked me to see if I could do something with them. And they had lost $50 million on their revenue, $420 million revenue. I was intrigued by that. I realized it wasn't a slam dunk to go fix it. When you're sinking, speed is actually quite important. I mean, if the ship is sinking, you gotta figure out a way to put those holes, you know, away or fix them somehow so the ship doesn't seem to sink. And they had a plan, an elaborate plan, to lose $25 million. And they said, well, that's half what we lost last year. So I said, why do you need to plan your own demise? You know, that kind of happens automatically if you don't do anything. So we said, well, let's try and do something different. But the amount of data we had to look at was incredible. But the way we used the data was pretty destructive. It was a serious case of analysis paralysis. So when you have all that data and you don't know what to do with it, that's a good learning point, I think, for all your students is, if there's too much data and you don't know how it's connected to what you're trying to do with the business, it's going to be destructive and nothing's going to happen. I'll just give you a little bit of example. They were saving money. That's, of course, if you lose money, you've got to save money, right? And they had decided they were going to have one flagpole instead of three. You know, you had this South Carolina flag, you had a South Carolina flag, you had a Cameron flag, and you had the U.S. flag. They had all three on one flagpole. So it took basically a platoon of folks to raise the flag every day and take it down, because you got to take it down at night, of course. Twice a week, you got all entangled, so you had to get a guy with a truck and another crew to figure out a way to take the flags down. So one of the first investments in Kevin was to buy two more flagpoles. And then I invested in three lights. Because actually, I don't know if you know that, but if you have a light shining on the flag, you don't have to take it down. So we saved some money doing that. We also realized that we had to sort of put a foundation in place so that we had a way to work together. We had to flatten the organization. And I think when you think of organizations today, taking layers out is probably almost always a good thing to do. Getting the people creating the activity closer to the customer is probably always a good thing. And you need, so that what that does is two things, it gets a more customer-centric operation as well as a people-centric operation. We realized we had to produce in a different place because it was too expensive in the place that we produced, so we had some really complicated restructuring activities to do. And we had to brand the company. The company's been around a long time. Had a great brand in many engineering communities, but it wasn't actually done. And we had to put common goals in place, but of course individual ownership and accountability. And maybe most importantly, when you're losing money, the math got to work. If the math doesn't work, that's all you're going to talk about. If the math works, you're not talking much about that. When the math doesn't work, that's what you're doing. And also, you got to put you can't win all the time, right? So you need to be able to give people an opportunity to allow a trial balloon to be launched, and then learn from that, and hopefully don't do it too many times, same mistake too many times. But shared leadership is clearly an important part of making a company successful. But we also have to have a plan long term. So we put together something we call the adjacency matrix. And what that basically meant was that we started from the left, and that's the product we make today, capacitors, these things. And then we said, well, let's try and see if we can go deeper by doing, we did these at the time, go deeper by actually being able to make these. You know, these sell for fractions of a penny, these sells for 50 bucks. So it's better to make a bunch of those than a bunch of these, maybe. So we wanted to broaden that or deepen that capability. We also wanted to go into other components as we move forward. So we decided to go and buy things, which really, in my view, is technology with a revenue stream. That's what you do. You're buying technology with a revenue stream. So we went, not on a buying spree, I wouldn't say that, but we also were very U.S.-centric in our business. In those days, 65% of our business was in the U.S., and the rest was split between Asia and Europe. Today, that number is 20% in the U.S., the rest in the world. So things have changed. But we bought a company called EFCOS. EFCOS was part of a company in Germany, that gave us a foothold in Europe. At the time, we had 40 people in Europe. Now we probably have 2,000. And it got us into automotive. And if you're in this business, if you're not in automotive, you're in bad trouble. So we had to get into automotive and get into the Europe. So we paid approximately $100 million for a $120 million business at the time. And that got us into companies like Bosch, Continental, Hella. And this means BMW, Mercedes, Audi, and those folks. And our market share in this particular capability grew from 14% to 21%. Then we bought a company called Evos Riffa, which was a concoction of three companies, one from Finland, one from Sweden, and one from England. Had manufacturing facilities in those three countries, in Germany and also in China. And that gave us capabilities that allowed us to go into the industrial business, also alternative energy capabilities. This is an old Evos Riffa product. We paid a little bit of $38 million in cash, and now we started this thing about assuming debt. And the reason we assumed debt was because we didn't have the money to pay it all. So we figured out a way. We assume a little bit of debt, and we'll just figure it out along the way. So we made that deal, and then we went to did the third one, Arcatronics. And this was sort of over a year and a half ago. And that got us real serious. This is an Arcatronics product that's used for automotive as well. And now we had to assume a lot more debt because we didn't have any more cash. So we paid 17 million euros for the business and assumed $150 million of debt. So we were a bit leveraged, but the markets were nice. We thought, you know, everything was going fine. And just when you think you have it all figured out, this happened. Okay, so what does that do for us? Well, you know, we had a business and continued to do that. And yeah, we had money, but we didn't have a lot of money, but we had enough money to carry on what we had to carry on. But you know, there's a funny thing, and those of you in business know what impairment tests are. How many of you know what an impairment test is? All right.
I do.
All right. A public company has to do that every year. But it basically is looking to see what the company is worth. And if it's not worth what you have on the books, you have to write it down, which means it's worth less. Nothing else changes. And most people who look at companies' performance disregard this. It's just an accounting, you know, SEC gap kind of thing, right? Well, that may be the case, but in our case, it was a little different because we actually got the impairment, we wrote it down, $156 million, the value of the company, and we also had, there was a little trick to this. We had a little note to seven insurance companies, whose name I still remember, that note had a debt-to-equity covenant, meaning that, you know, if the equity went down, then of course we would trip this covenant, in case we had to pay the debt back. Yeah, $50 million, not a lot of money for a big company. Well, $50 million is an enormous amount of money if you don't have it. So now, and they wanted it back quickly, of course. So I didn't have a lot of ideas, and of course this is the middle of the recession, so you talk to your friendly bankers. Fifth Third, would you have helped me back in 2008?
We've been challenged. Sure.
But anyway, so it was a difficult place in the world. So what did we have? What could we do? Well, I knew, I had met a man called Felix Zandman. Felix Zandman built a business called Vishay, competitor of mine. But I knew he wanted a particular capability I had just acquired. It's called webcam, but it doesn't matter. But it's very, not big, but very profitable. So I called him, and I liked him, and I think he liked me too for some reason. And his personal story is unbelievable. I mean, he comes to a village called Vishay, which now is in eastern Poland. It was in Lithuania at the time, I think, or part of the Soviet Union. And he survived the war in a potato zone. After after the war was over, he got out of the cellar, went to Paris, got his PhD, started his global business, settled many billions of business all over the world. Very nice. So I called him and said, well, Dr. Sandman, why don't we get together and see if this little business that you always wanted to buy, if you are willing to do that. So he said, so we met in Berlin on August 5th, I remember this. August 5th, it was hot, in his office. And I said, I'm willing to sell you this crown jewel of mine that you really want. And he says, yeah, I want it. It was a $16 million business in terms of revenue. So not very. And he said, I'll pay you 35 for it. I said, Felix, it don't help me. I need 50. Well, I can't pay 50. The board won't let me buy it for 50. So I said, well, Felix, why don't we try something different? You buy it for 50, and then you lend me 50. And I'll pay you back in 3 years. On the board there. He said, okay. So we got a yellow pad, and we wrote down this agreement. And we both signed it. I think he took the yellow piece. I think I got a copy, but doesn't matter. And then we got our lawyers together, which of course slowed everything. You know, Jamie, my lawyer, he's, I love him dearly, but you know, you got to make sure you manage your lawyers, otherwise. Otherwise, you know, whatever. But so he had a team of lawyers, and we had a team of lawyers, and we had to manage our team of lawyers to get this thing done. And in 3 weeks, the business was sold, I had the money, paid off the debt, and we were on going. But we still had our adjacency matrix to do, right? We still had more things to do, and we still hadn't done anything in Japan, which we wanted to do and needed to do. But we also had some short-term loans. And if anybody know anything about short-term loans, the market do not like short-term loans, because they think you're going to default and you're going to go bankrupt and so forth. My loans was with a Japanese bank, with an Italian bank, or two Italian banks. And you know, I told when we bought Arcatronics, we had we assumed $150 million in debt in Italy. It was most in Italy, and it was all short term. But the Italians, you know, they don't work as quickly as Wall Street seemed to think they should. But I was telling the investors that, hey, they don't want the keys to my plant in Italy. They're going to make this. They're going to figure out a way to do this, but nobody believed it. So the stock went down to 8 pennies. 8 cents. And of course, we got kicked off the New York Stock Exchange as a result. And now we had to figure out a way to finance some things. How are we going to take us from where we are now to where we are going? Because we still had to do a Japanese deal. And we still had to grow the company. And we still believed that we could do this once we figured out a way to get the money. There wasn't a long line of financial companies willing to help us, I have to say. But one day, a company based in Los Angeles called Platinum Equity, and they wanted to buy the whole company. We said, no, we're not going to do that. But they said, well, if you give us some warrants, meaning that they, you know, at a later date they can cash it in and make some money, they allowed us they gave us some money so we could actually take and go and liquidate some of our debt. And if you remember, those of you who were in those times, you could actually get a pretty decent haircut on your loan. So on the loans we had, with the money that Platinum gave us, we gave them some warrants, we could take 60% off our debt. So, and then we sold the machining business, gave us another $20 million. So we were now doing okay. And we got back on the New York Stock Exchange. November of 2010. So, we're doing okay. However, this is Tantalum ore in its original form. And those who were digging for this, the miners, were basically putting prices at a level where we could not sustain. So we had to figure something out. We had to, what are we going to be able to do to cut the price of this so we can make this and put it into this and sell it to a customer. Well, Dodd-Frank came along, and I love that legislation. not because I'm bankers or I don't care about that. That's fine. But what they also did, they put a section 1502 in that legislation. We talked about conflict minerals. And why was that important for us? And why did that give us an opportunity to do something completely different? Well, the best or easiest to get to of this, which actually you don't have to drill for in Congo, you can actually dig it up, is in the Congo. But of course, Congo is a place where you don't want anything from the Congo. You know, we talk about conflict, you talk about blood diamonds, right? They talked about blood tantalum because they were going into this, and when you buy a cell phone and have tantalum in it, and you know, kids are working there and they're funding the militia and whatever. But the legislation gave us a playbook in how can you go into the Congo and actually extract the ore at a different price. So I called my friend John Crowley, who is a Brit, kind of an interesting guy in many ways. And he was born in Africa. He knew Africa really, really well. And I said, John, can you, and I knew nothing about mining or geology or any of that. I said, can you find me a miner in the Congo so we can go into the Congo and extract the mineral from there and work with, use the legislation as a playbook for how we could actually ensure that the minerals that we are extracting from the Congo is actually conflict-free in a legal sense. Because that would allow us to go to these guys and say, this stuff is actually made from stuff in the Congo, but it's conflict-free in a legal sense. Mm-hmm. So I went to the Congo. I had never been before. I hired a helicopter. Because they had a concession way up in the bush someplace. They hired it. so at that time, I got into the helicopter, and they loaded, Jerry, you know, some petrol or some aviation fuel into, and jerry cans into the helicopter. We were sitting on these fuel dumps in the helicopter. And I said, he was French. He didn't speak in English. My French is, that's okay. But at least we could communicate to a degree. And he said, well, listen, this helicopter ride is at least 4 hours. We can't stay up for 4 hours, and we need to stop for fuel. And there are no gas stations between here and over there. So we rode for 2 hours, landed, filled up the fuel, and went to the village. And the first time I went, it was an amazing experience. Thousands of people were there with their shovels and axes, and they were, you know, it was like a movie. And what we found in the village was folks mining like this. Sort of the way they did it in California in the mid-1800s. but we figured out a way to do this. We figured out a way to put a system in place where we actually first started by making an industrial mine in the Congo, which is not so, it's complex and not super complicated, but you had to get the most difficult thing was to get the equipment to the village because the roads weren't really that good. And in the first instance, when we got this out, we had to take motorbikes to get from the village down there. So we managed to do that. We actually built a chemical plant in Matamoros around where we make our anodes or some of our parts. And we bought a powder making company that takes this stuff. This is the powder. You can take a look at this stuff when after the but that we make into our capacity. We bought that in Nevada. And we started doing this. And it basically changed that entire business. From doing, we had a gross margin at the time of 9%. And you can't run anything on a gross margin of 9%. At least not for long. Now, that business on a blended basis in the mid-30s. So it went from absolute catastrophe to a very nice, very nice business. And got customers to be able to appreciate this as well. But, you know, there are a lot of people who think this is very expensive. And if you look up the internet or Wikipedia and you look at Dodd-Frank and conflict minerals, you say that the cost for US companies is $8 billion. And that's the biggest BS I've ever heard. Because they have no idea. I have actually done it. It cost us less than 1% from the cost of the material to do this. And the way we do it is we get the stuff from the mine, and from artisanal miners as well, just like the guy with the pan, and we put it in the bag, we weigh it at the site, and then we tag it. And then we follow that bag from the village of Kasinga, which is where the mine is, down through the bush, about 170 k, so 110 miles, across Lake Tanganyika, which is the size of Belgium, through Tanzania, on railroads that were built by the Germans before the First World War in the late 1800s. And then we take it on ship back to the plant. And we are trying to make sure that legislation stays in place. Because we worry that people that make these, if the legislation is not there, would worry about whether people are following the rules. So we're very engaged in that. But of course, we had to do other things too. So we had to make moves of, so we had some other business that we had to take care of in Europe in particular, because we were in the wrong place. And we were looking for a plant in Eastern Europe. We actually had a facility in the town called Kustendil, which I'm sure you've never heard of. It's an interesting place to visit. I wouldn't, you know, you don't need to wear your bathing suits to Kustendil, I can assure you. But it's in western Bulgaria. And basically, we had run out of engineers in the whole town. So we couldn't expand our business in that city. So we needed to find another place. And I was sitting in Paris watching CNN International. And this thing comes up. Invest in Macedonia. And how many have been to Macedonia in this room? You don't mind me telling, right? That's fine. Of course, I knew that. And I called up Chuck, who ran our business, and I said, "Chuck, have you been to Macedonia?" He said, "Who?" I hadn't been either. I knew where it was, and I know how big it was or how small it was. I know the capital was Skopje. So let's try and see what we can do. Because we had to move a lot of activity from Western Europe into Eastern Europe. And today, we have one of our best plants in Macedonia. The first person we hired was Vesna, right there. So he was the one who hired the first couple hundred people in the plant. And now she works in Fort Lauderdale and part of our global HR team. But we moved nine plants. We closed nine plants globally, built two, and moved 74 production lines across the globe. But back to Japan. So we went to Tokyo and met with NEC Corporation, who owned this company called NEC Tokyo. And we knew them since a long time, because we had a technical partnership with them for many years. And they actually are the ones who invented a particular part of the capacitor that we thought was the future in a particular style. So we had a conversation with them, and yes, they were sort of interested in forming a partnership and maybe somehow we would acquire them. I had no idea how we were going to fund this. I had no idea what kind of structure we were going to have, but let's start the conversation. So it was going really, really well, and just when I thought I had it all figured out, this happened. To the left, you see pictures from the flood in Thailand in 2011. And if you know anything about electronics or electronic manufacturing, 8 feet of water and electronic manufacturing do not mix well. So their entire factory that produced the stuff we liked the most was completely destroyed. Nothing was saved. And to make matters worse, on the right side, if you remember, that's a picture of an earthquake and tsunami in northern Japan, right where the Japanese plants were. So now we have two natural disasters that are affecting this company right one after the other. We didn't know how to do that, but the interesting thing with the Japanese, once they decide to do something, it's like a Shinkansen train, you know, the bullet train in Japan. And they were able to build a new factory in Thailand basically. Amazing. So we continued, and we managed to put together a joint venture with NEC. We paid a little bit of money to get into the joint venture because we didn't have much. But of course, at the end, we were going to pay a little bit more. And I'm going to give you some details on this here friends to be there because it's sort of an interesting deal in many ways. At the time, they were not doing so well. They had an EBITDA, or cash profit, if you want to call it that, of $7 million on a $500 million revenue. We had agreed that in the contract with them that we will start the joint venture, and in a few years, we'll buy the company for 6x EBITDA. 6x7 is kind of a small number. And then we will repay the debt to NEC, and we figure we can find a way to finance that somehow. So we had a plan, and we started to, you know, improve the company, and we would make things happen, and the performance happened. One thing I learned the first time I started working with these people in Token, that they had great budgets. So the budgets were like this, up into the right-hand corner. So one thing I learned, something I tried to teach these folks when I was there is, don't be a hero at budget time. Wrong time to be a hero. Make sure you have a budget you can meet. So we put together budgets they can meet, and they're starting to do real well. And you know, we've been working now for many years together, and they haven't missed the budgets since. So we were doing really well. We thought we had a way to get this thing done really quickly. So just when you think you have it all figured out, this happened. In Japan, nothing to do with Kemah. Let me just say that. And I have to say, since I have Jamie sitting here, Jamie, nothing to do with Japan. Right? Nothing to do with Kemah, right? Nothing to do. But eight Japanese companies were investigated for price fixing. There were no documentation about any of this price fixing, but it clearly had happened. So we were sort of stuck in the muck. Now we can't move forward with the transaction, of course, because we needed to know what the ramifications of this would be going forward. But the company, of course, was doing better. So the EBITDA calculation, and the way you look at EBITDA, you take away this one-time expenses out of the EBITDA. Those who know what EBITDA is, earnings before interest and then depreciation and so forth and taxes. And so you take away all the one-time costs. So the EBITDA was going through the roof. But of course the cost of litigation and fines was big, but they were not part of the EBITDA calculation. So the 6x EBITDA was a big number, also was the fines and whatever else was also a big number. So that really didn't work for us. So suddenly, to buy the company now was like $500 million. And we did not have $500 million. And I didn't have it. There was no business agent on the sideline that could buy something for $500 million either. So but that didn't really work. So we had to find a different way of doing this. And what we did, and I'm going to go through these numbers a little bit in detail. What we actually did was, we struck a deal with NEC that why don't we try and sell something that NEC token has that could pay for a bunch of the transaction. We own 34% of the company, they own 66% of the company. But the deal we struck was, yes, we will take a division. We decided to take a division that had its manufacturing in the Philippines, very focused on automotive, which I thought was okay because we were very heavy automotive anyway. So being a little less automotive is probably fine. And let's see if we can find a buyer for this business and use that to fund the transaction in some sort of way. But it's also culturally sensitive, of course. So the president of the joint venture, who kind of worked for me, I was the chairman of the board, but he had a different view. So my joint venture partner, NEC, told me, you have to convince Oyama-san, the president of the joint venture, that this is a good thing for him to do. So I had to convince him that selling your best business is really a good thing to do. Took me 6 months. But what happened was the following. We sold this EMD division for $422 million, 10x EBITDA. At the time, with Kemet being, you know, that was 2x our market cap, by the way, at the time. Not so now, but at the time. Because nobody believed our story that this was going to happen. So we sold the company for $422 million. And then we agreed, of course, there was some costs for the transaction, but we were going to split the proceeds from the sale, which was $94.5 million. And then we were going to pay $52 million for the remaining shares. But we got $94 million. So basically, when it all said and done, they gave us $42 million to buy the business. And then the cash that the joint venture had was also ours. That was $160 million. So we got, in a sense, $200 million plus the business. It's called a bargain purchase. The SEC that we haven't had a letter from the SEC yet, but we expect one at one point. But so somehow, but then again, everybody was happy because NEC got their loan back, $220 million that they didn't think they would get back. They got $50 million from us for the shares, and they got $94.5 million for half the proceeds of the sale. So what this basically did is just recreated another Kennet in many ways and have given us an opportunity to play another game of golf, at least, as we move this forward. So let me talk a little bit about what we are looking at now. What are we going to do going forward? What's our next game? If you look at the way the world looks today, and many, many people are talking about that, and I think the Airbnb is kind of funny because his son who lives in New York, and he, when he was out of cash, he used to stay with a friend and had his apartment let through Airbnb, and the housing association figured that out and threw him out, so that was not so smart. But anyway, but you look at all these things. Uber, biggest taxi company in the world, has no vehicles. Facebook, the world largest media company, is not responsible for any of the content and, you know, doesn't really create any of it. And Alibaba, of course, is the largest retailer which has no inventory. But these are things that are what are happening now in the world, which when we look at what are we going to be doing going forward, we have to stay technologically relevant. And therefore, we need to understand where the technology is going. So we all have these, right? We make little things like this, which go into things like this. But the way they look, it doesn't matter, you know, for us. So we just need to make sure that we understand that this is something that's going to happen, and we need to be able to create the capability we have so we can sell to these companies. Electric vehicles. Those of you who don't believe that's going to be going to flood the market, think again. Today, if you take electric plus hybrid, it's about 2 million a year being produced out of the 97 million cars, light vehicles, you know, light trucks are being produced in the world. China is, of course, leading the way, as you would expect. Volvo has said that they are going to stop producing combustion engine cars by 2020, Audi by 2025. Norway has said you can't sell a combustion engine car in Norway after 2025. India has said by 2030 you can't sell a combustion engine car. France is 2040 and the UK is 2040 as well. I'm not sure I believe India in 2030, but I do believe Norway. That is absolutely going to happen. And for us, this is a huge market because these things, they're called ceramic capacitors. In a combustion engine car, you would have 3,000 of these little things in the car. In an electric vehicle car, you have 10,000. So the demand is just like this. And also, when you think about what's going on in the world on things like image recognition. Today, you know, this is not the 10, so it can't do it. But the 10 can kind of do it. I was involved in this in the mid-90s with ATM machines, trying to do retina recognition on ATMs. It didn't actually work well enough to be able to do it. But this is happening and requires a lot of bandwidth and a lot of technology. And for every 600 of these that's being sold, we need one more server. So there's a projection that says we're going to have 600 million more servers, 400 million more servers in the next 4 or 5 years. People are worried about privacy, of course. And I know, that, James, you had a great guy speaking at the Broward workshop the other day about that specifically. And it's worrisome, but making these sort of things, that's good. Because you're going to find countries, regulators, going to require that we protect the privacy of the data. And for every bit of data that you put on Google or you put on Facebook, there's going to be another bit of data that's going to protect that data. So that means that there's 2x required for the same data that was 1x before. So I think that's going to be actually a good thing, a good thing for our industry. So when you think about Cameron going forward, this is how we are trying to be technologically relevant. Just give you a few my insights of this is blue themes, actually, what I believe. Having been in China maybe 60, 70 times, built my first plant in China in 1995. Didn't work very well, but it was kind of interesting. The last 10 years in China was built from business to business. The next 10 years are going to be business to consumer. Electric vehicles are going to replace combustion engine cars so fast in China we don't even know how fast it's going, in my opinion. They are shared, you know, collaborative consumption is a new trend in many ways. So, you know, you share the car, you share something, you don't own it much. And that's big in China. Alibaba, you know, we talk about Amazon shipping things with drones. Alibaba's already doing that. And there's a lot of very savvy, digital savvy citizens in China. Now let me tell you a little story. A couple weeks ago, we have a big plant in Suzhou, China. Suzhou is a small Chinese town of about 10 million people, in a little west of Shanghai. Actually, a very pretty town, actually. I was in Tokyo, so I was going to fly to Suzhou, and I didn't bring all my luggage because it's going to be there for a day, and so I took some stuff in the bag and I went, and I had a big canister of shaving cream. I figured I'd be caught in security, so I didn't bring that. I said, I'll buy one when I get to Suzhou. So I get to Suzhou and do my stuff and have dinner and blah, blah, blah. Forgot to buy the shaving cream, of course. So I asked the guy at the front desk, you know, do you have a shaving kit that I can have? And he says, it has been delivered. So, probably didn't speak English very well or something. After all, I was in China, right? So I walk up to my room, 22nd floor. I open the door, the phone rings. So I walk over to the phone, and there's an automated voice that says, it is at your door. Walk over, open the door, and I see this thing. And it's swiveling, you know, and the light's blinking. Right. So, whoa, what the hell is this? So it had two buttons on the top. One was green and one was red. And it said some things in Chinese. I didn't understand, of course. But I figured the green is probably better than red. So I push the green, a little door opens on the side, and there is my shaving. In China, a couple weeks ago. In Norway, this is a cargo ship, or three actually cargo ships. They're not so big. They can hold about 100 containers, which of course means 100 trucks if you do it by truck. They are completely autonomous. Electric. They can't go so far. They can only go 65 nautical miles. But they'll fix that. So this is also happening. So and they need a lot of the stuff to be able to take those ships autonomously from point A to point B. So a lot of very interesting things that are happening in the world of technology. And I would ask you to, if you ever met anyone who's happy with the bandwidth they are experiencing. And if you meet that person, I like to meet him or her. But a couple of things that I've learned on my route. Particularly dealing with Asia. There are five P's that I think you have to think about. You have to be polite. It doesn't work to go in and start yelling and screaming. That is not going to work. You need to be patient. I wasn't born with that trait. So that's something I have acquired by dealing with these. But also you have to be persistent. You need to know what you want to do and make sure you keep pushing in a polite and patient way, of course. And you need to be present. You know, Warren Buffett said that if you want to see eye to eye, you got to meet face to face. In the East, that is so true. And you need to be passionate. You also have to take the long view of things. And I'll give you an example. In 2001, a researcher, a chemist at Cambridge, invented a particular part of a particular powder type of this that actually would work extremely well if it was implanted in the body. Don't ask me to explain it any more than that. But anyway, so we patented it. In 2006, one of the largest medical device makers in the world wanted that capability. So they asked us if they could buy our patent. And we said, you can, but only for medical devices, and only if we are to manufacture that device when you actually need to manufacture. So they agreed, 2006, 5 years later. In 2013, we made our first, it's a defibrillator actually, 12 years. So we have to have a long period. And you also, but you also have to be quick sometimes. So even if you take a long view, you have to be quick. And you have to make the team work. It's a collaborative effort. It's a team sport, for sure. You know, if you remember, well, having heard about it, what Benjamin Franklin said at the eve of the signing of the Declaration of Independence back in 1776, I guess it was. And he said, we must hang together, or we should most assuredly hang separately. And I've had the opportunity to be around the block a few times. So a few things that I've learned along the way. First one is, if you want to do what I do, you need to have one area where you are 5 to 9 questions deep. You need to know something really, really deep. And then everything else, you got to be at least 2 questions deep. So, and you need to understand finance. You need to be able to communicate the subject, and the math has to work. Otherwise, as I said before, that's all you're going to talk about. And you know, you can, from an accounting perspective, you can lose money for a long time, as long as you have some cash and you have a lot of depreciation and blah blah blah. But you can only run out of cash once. And I can't say I've been there, but I've been darn close. I would say never go against your gut, but make sure you have data to prove that you got it correct. See the big picture, but check the details. You must have a good work-life balance. Whether I have or not, we will not debate that, but you do. And you need to make sure that the people that you have working for you have a decent program to be able to do that. You know, weight, exercise, a good health program, et cetera, et cetera. Mens sana in corpore sano is Latin for a healthy mind and a healthy body. And I think that's so true. You need to make sure you pick a good boss. Probably the most important choice you need to pick a good guy to work for. And embrace technology. Digitize everything you can, and then some. And when you negotiate, whatever you negotiate, if it is, I've had the opportunity to negotiate with Italian union guys. And of course, I don't speak Italian pretty well, and he doesn't speak English, so we have to do it in different languages, but. You know, try to put yourself in his position. You know, here are jobs that have to disappear, and these people are going to be unemployed in some shape or form. You know, think about what he's trying to do, and be empathetic there in his position. Walk a mile in their shoes. remember also, you know, when you're set to go to negotiate and you go to your board and say, I'm going to have this negotiation with this company, and they give you all kinds of advice. And what I always try to say to my fellow board members, often with a little smile on my face so they don't get too upset with me, I say, it's very easy to negotiate when the other guy is not in the room. And also strive for a win-win in whatever you do. The implementation of the business is going to be so much easier if everybody feels good about the merger. Bob Rosen has said that in business, trust is the most valuable coin. And business, as I said, is a team sport. And when you're involved in a turnaround situation, whatever you do, when you have to cut quick, and then focus on the people that stay around. And have a team that will say their point of view, and make sure that they are not just keeping their mouth shut, and make sure they tell you what you need to know. Communication is absolutely critical. What also is critical is to give back. So let me tell you a little bit about what happened in Africa. I had the opportunity to meet the governor of Katanga province, Moise Katumba, and he said to me, if you want this to work, you need to do something for the village. And we took that to heart, and we figured, how are we going to do that? Well, we got the village elders together and asked them to give us a list of things they want us to do. And if, I don't know how good your French is, but Route, Hôpital, École, that's roads and bridges and schools. Hospital and school. That, those were the things that they wanted us to work with. So what we did was we built a hospital. To the left is what it looked like. I don't know what we call it a hospital. It was the clinic in the village. Right? To the right is what we have now. We built a school. And you think of doing calculus sitting on a mud floor with not even a blackboard to help you out. And we built the school. We dealt with water. And when you sum it all up, the hospital probably does 10,000 patients a year. The school has 1,500 students. We've basically eliminated many diseases through the water. We've got solar-powered street lights. And we got great Wi-Fi, actually, in a part of the village. And I'll tell you a funny story about that, the Wi-Fi. Because we have Wi-Fi, people could buy a cell phone, right? Because it would work. But the problem is there's no electricity in the village. So how do they charge the cell phone? And we noticed that we were losing our solar panels off the street lights. So, one of my guys who was there, he went around the village and he saw, well, I know where the solar panels are called. And of course, they had to be visible because, you know, they need the sun, but you can't hide it because it doesn't work. So they had figured out how to charge cell phones with the solar panels that were off on our street lights. I don't know how many of you could have figured out how to do that. This was in the middle of the bush. So we figured we'll do something, we'll create some, you know, at the water wells, we will put charging stations for the cell phones so they can do something. So we're really committed to doing this, and it feels really good. We have made a huge improvement of our business service and have been able to help a little bit, you know, getting a life that's a little bit more decent than this. And we're also coming to Fort Lauderdale. It doesn't look like this yet, but I don't know if you recognize the building, but it's 1 East Broward. So that is where we're moving our headquarters to, and we'll move in, in the next X month, probably 6 months time. So we've decided to make Fort Lauderdale more of our home than it is, and we have found a great people hired here. We found a diverse group of people. Everybody speaks at least 2 languages, pretty much. Some 3, 4. We're committed to making this our home. And as you may know, that we have started a program with NSU where we're looking for data analytics capable folks, and we've got some competitions going on, and we have some scholarships in the wings. And of course, our motivation, apart from being nice, is the fact that we like to find the good talents that we can hire. And let me just finish by talking about where we are. If you look at this picture, it says Kemet. You will find us everywhere. You have a lot of our stuff. I wouldn't say don't go and you know, dismantle your television to find where our products are, but they are in many ways. And you can pick all of these places just by taking a picture of the intercoastal, where our products are based. So, in summary, you need a long view. And you need to have actions ongoing all the time. You need to be kind, actually. Being nice is actually not a bad thing. It's undervalued, I guarantee you. If you show some kindness, it comes back in more. Being fair is important. Being good to people, they're good to you. It's not so complicated. And you need to be passionate. And as Oscar Wilde, the Irish playwright, said over 100 years ago, be yourself. Everyone else is already taken. Thank you.
We have time for questions, students.
I don't think we are. We are presenting a lot in various conferences, but I don't think we're doing anything there.
I went there last year. It was hosted at Yale. It was a wonderful conference, and I just thought that your project would be a great addition to their conference.
Thank you.
Other questions? This is James Donnelly. He's also a member of the Hall of Fame. Mr. Donnelly, please stand and be recognized.
Mayor, thank you. Great job, as always. So if you were sitting in this audience, I don't want to say how many years ago, and you had to do one thing different than what you did, what would it be?
I said no to a couple of opportunities that I shouldn't have said. I had the opportunity once to go run a huge business in southern France. Now, why everybody says no to living in the, you know, near, I have no idea what I did. I probably shouldn't have. I was running a little business, it's been digital, running a little business, and they offered me to run a different business somewhere else. And I kind of didn't say no to that too. So basically the message is, you know, when the opportunity is presented, take it. Mm-hmm. I never had a plan. I mean, I had no idea what I was going to do. But you go in there and the opportunity presents itself and take it. So we have a club that we created when I was a little bit 15 years old, I think we were. And the motto was take it easy, but take it. So.
Thank you.
Although Warren Buffett is, tell you a funny story. Warren Buffett bought a distributor of ours, Paul Pitya, huge customer of ours. And Paul Andrews, the president of TPI, he wants to retire. And he's 74 years old. And of course, Warren Buffett is 88. So we said, Paul, what's the problem?
Yes, please.
The career decisions you've made, how many of those have been driven by money, by making money? In terms of going from one company to another?
Meaning personally?
Yes. Yeah.
Well, you know, in the sense of my case, I was made unemployed. So that was I don't think, I mean, clearly money is not unimportant. And clearly it's sometimes better to have more than less. I don't think I've made any decisions to do something just for the money. When I was in LA, I was offered a job to be the CIO of a company in Fernando Valley, and they were offering me 3x what I was making. I don't think so, but clearly I don't mind the money. the resources go to it out. I don't think you should. I think it's more important that you pick the opportunity and the people you work for and make sure that you feel good about the place you are. And I think you want to work for a company that's good to you and good to the community and good to its customers and make you feel better. And make you do it.
One last question, yes, please.
I teach strategic management and preparing for discontinuities that we don't anticipate. And Henry Minster from McGill University talks about a deliberate strategy and an emergent strategy. We never really know what will really happen in spite of your best plans. So how do you teach this whole idea of being opportunistic to students? Because in strategy courses, we tell them how to come up with the best optimal deliberate strategy, but how do you make them feel that it's more lucky, it's more good to be lucky than talented?
Well, let me turn that around. A talented person is lucky. So, but talent requires some persistent work and learning. Deliberate practice is something people call it. And, you know, you may have read the book about the 10,000-hour rule and so forth. And you know, I think deliberate practice is an important part of being better. Also, deliberate experimentation, which means you got to the balloon's got to fly a bit to see if that works. But I think you need to think about things to do, and you need to think about in which context you're going to operate. But then you're going to have to let the opportunities come and figure out a way to deal with it. For instance, we make hardware, right? We make things, atoms. But we want to use bits to sell the atoms. So we invest a lot in technology to make it easy for our customers to buy this stuff. And I've challenged my chief scientist to make a capacitor, which is all bits, the atoms, of course, to make one out of bits. He looked at me like, you know, I was sort of whatever. And I said, well, you're the smartest guy in the room. I have no idea, but maybe you do. So, you know, it's more of a joke, but I think you need to sort of try and figure out how can you look around the corner. And when things happen, because they do, you know, you don't know when Mother Nature's going to tell us something. She tells us something all the time. You don't know when the next crash is going to happen. But what I have learned is when the times are good, that's the time to prepare for the not so good times.
Thank you, Mr. Luke. I've been personally enriched by this lecture, and I hope you have too. And thank you so much for all that you've done, not only to make the world better, but also to impact us here tonight. Really,
I'm amazed that you guys all stayed for the whole thing.
Would you hand it back to say a few words?
Well, I too have been personally enriched. I thoroughly enjoyed this. I think the students enjoyed it because part of being one of the Hall of Fame members is that it gives an opportunity for those honorees to give back their knowledge. And Dr. Lu has definitely done that this evening, because just this morning I gave a book to the deans and the vice presidents. It's called Thinking Outside the Box. And if Pierre has not shown how just when you think things are going your way, what does it require you to do? Think outside of the box. And one of the greatest aspects of leadership is being able to do that and then inspire others that what you're saying has a great vision and a great opportunity, but he does it with integrity, persistence, passion, patience, and politeness. Isn't that a great lesson? Isn't that a great lesson? And that's why it's so important that I think that we heard what he had to say. And while we all stay here, thank you so much. Not a diploma, but it's definitely a certificate.
It looks like a diploma. I'll put it proudly on my wall. Thank you. Thank you very much.
I think we wanted to get a picture here. Yes. We got.